In this video, I'm going to describe a little bit about how we can construct small test cases around the idea of RISC-V assembly language and spell out the instructions for the assignment, which will basically consist of writing a small piece of assembly language code. The purpose of this is not so much to learn assembly language by heart. You are free to look up the instructions at any point and even to look up tutorials if necessary. It's more to get you familiar with the idea of how assembly language is written in general. What are some calling conventions? What are things to keep in mind when you write different kinds of code and so on? So the assignment itself is going to be write an assembly language program in RISC-V assembly language instructions, in particular the RV32I instruction set to compute the nth Fibonacci number. As we will see later, there are a number of pseudo instructions that are used in the test bench. The full reference for pseudo instructions is given in tables 26.2 and 26.3 of the RISC-V specification PDF documentation, which is available freely online and also available on the Microsoft Teams page. You can write this code either using these pseudo instructions or using the regular RV32I set. Both are acceptable. All right, so first things first, what are Fibonacci numbers? This should be familiar to most of you. The definition of the Fibonacci numbers is you start off with two values, 1 and 1. And every successive Fibonacci number is the sum of the previous two numbers. So for example, Fibonacci number 1 and Fibonacci number 2 are both equal to 1. The index values are shown on top. And the Fibonacci number 3 is 1 plus 1 equal to 2. Fibonacci number 4 is 1 plus 2 equal to 3. Fibonacci number 5 is 2 plus 3 equal to 5, Fibonacci number 6 is 3 plus 5 equal to 8, and so on. As you know, these start to grow very rapidly. In fact, it's a sort of exponential growth that you see in the number going further. A common style of writing code for computing the Fibonacci numbers is to use this recursive formulation shown below. This is basically Python code, but it's simple enough that you should be able to understand it or translate it into any other language that you want. Essentially, it says that if n is equal to 1 or n is equal to 2, return the value 1, else return fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2. Now, in this assignment, I'm going to assume that n is greater than 0. You don't need to handle special cases. And also, of course, that n is an integer. All right, so what's the tricky part over here? You are asked to write this in assembly language. And the way that this code has been written, of course, is in a recursive manner. Right, fib of n is defined in terms of fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2. Is recursion possible in assembly? Yes, it is. At the end of the day, any other language also compiles down to what can be disassembled into assembly language instructions. So it's definitely not impossible to write recursion in assembly. It's probably quite painful. On the other hand, the Fibonacci number computation can be written very efficiently, in fact, without using recursion. So that is left as an exercise to you. It's not very hard, but just think about it and see how you'll rewrite it without using recursion and in assembly language. The test setup, you will be given a test bench in assembly language and a template for what your fib function should look like. What you need to do is to fill up the code there for the fib function. Use the run.sh script that will be provided in order to verify that it actually works correctly and passes the test cases. Run.sh will essentially just call the assembler, convert it into a executable, and use the spike simulator to run the program and test whether it passed or failed. Now, after you submit offline on the server, a few more tests will be conducted just to make sure that it is actually working correctly and your code overall works properly under more cases than what is provided in the test setup, which means that you should probably also test it out more thoroughly on your own. Fibonacci numbers are simple enough that there's not much testing really to be done. But in general, as a matter of course, for subsequent assignments at least, you need to keep this in mind. The test cases that are provided to you are only a sample set. What will finally be run as test cases will be a larger set, which you will need to make sure pass. You are not given that larger set. So how do you know that it is going to pass? The only way is basically to make sure that what you have done is correct. and complete. It should not be something which solves only the specific test cases or only, you know, some of the some subset of the overall functionality, which is enough to pass the test cases provided to you. The structure of the test bench looks like this. As like any other assembly language code, the first thing is going to be that, you know, you declare one statement basically saying that there's a global identifier, a global label with the name underscore start. The reason for having this global label is because, once again, convention, the assembler is set up to look for that label and take that as the starting point in the ELF file. Because after all, the assembler converts it into object code. The LD, the linker and loader, then takes that object code, combines it with some other functions, and creates an ELF file. That ELF file contains a .text section, which is essentially going to be the starting point of the actual executed code. What that means is that ELF file needs to know which part of your assembly is going to be the starting point of your program. And by convention, the label underscore start is used in order to indicate that this is the starting point of the program. Now, you'll recall that when you're writing a C program, it uses a different label. That label is called main. Right? And the reason for that is because C programs have a different sort of runtime set of libraries that they invoke. And when you combine all of them together, it finally, the ELF file sort of behaves the same way. The operating system essentially needs to load it into memory and then activate it. It needs to know which is the starting point. So what happens inside this test bench? You can see the first four instructions. For example, LIA0,6, call fib, LIA5,8, and BNEA0A5.fail. That is essentially the structure of one test. What does it mean? It means that I load the value A0, or rather the value 6, into the register A0. Couple of things to keep in mind. LI is a pseudo instruction. There is no actual instruction called LI in the RV32I instruction set. So what does that actually mean? Because all the load instructions in RISC-V actually try to load something from memory. Whereas what we are trying to do here is take an immediate value, 6, and put it into a register, A0. Once again, A0 is not the same as X0, where the registers in RISC-V are X0 to X31. A0 has some other name, once again provided in the ABI documentation as given in the RISC-V specification. So LIA0,6 actually translates into some other RV32I instructions, but the effective result is that the value 6 is loaded into the register A0. Then we have the instruction call fib. Once again, call is a pseudo instruction. What actually happens is a jump and link. And as we will see later, what this jump and link does is it saves the present address where you are, the present value of the program counter, into some particular register, and then jumps to the location, the address location given by the label fib. Now, where is fib? You can't see it in this particular snippet of code. We'll get to that later. The net result of that call is that after going to fib and executing instructions over there, there'll be a jump back to the location immediately after the call. That is to say LIA5,8. Now, what is this LIA5,8? We know that the expected result is 8. We load that into the register A5. And the assumption is that the function fib would have taken whatever value it computed for the sixth Fibonacci number and saved that back into the register A0, which means that I am now checking whether A0 is equal to A5. If they are not equal, I jump to the label .fail. I can have more such tests. At the end of all of the tests, I put the value 0 into A5 and I jump to .pass. Now, look carefully at this. What it's doing is if any one of the test cases fails, it jumps to .fail, where it puts the value 1 into A5. If all of them pass, it puts the value 0 into A5 and jumps to .pass. And in .pass, what do? We basically take whatever was the value in A5, move it into the register A0, because after the reason for this is that the value that is finally there in A0 is the one that is actually returned to the operating system. And then we load the value 93 into A7. This is the system call number for exit. And we do an ecall to return back to the operating system. So what does the function itself look like? You can write this in a separate file. And the template that is given to you is, it just consists of three lines. The first and most important is that there is a .globalFib. And this .globalFib will essentially identify the label where you are starting your code. After that, you have the li A0,8, which in this case is a particular piece of code which will pass only this particular test, the sixth Fibonacci number, and a JR, which is a jump return, return to whatever was stored in the return address register. Your goal, as far as this assignment is concerned, is to complete the rest of this, right? You need to actually fill out assembly language instructions into this file, and the run.sh script that will be provided to you will take care of actually compiling it and running it. Keep in mind that you need to actually make sure that you are actually solving the Fibonacci problem, because we will be testing against other cases. Like I said, in Fibonacci, it's fairly trivial, but in other examples and the further assignments, you will need to make sure that you are sort of testing for additional test cases beyond what is given to you, so that you make sure that your system is actually working properly.